It's my pleasure to now introduce Simon Zornes. Simon Zornes is a leader in his community. He's an artist and historian, and a member of the White Earth Nation, who's attended the Wahpeton and Flandreau Indian schools, an avid reader of history, with a two-year degree in alternative energy, and he is also dedicated to the natural cycles of nature, in his own words. Please welcome Simon Zornes.
I tell most people I'm a member of Lighter, which is true, and I follow most things in Ojibwe. I try to learn about new Ojibwe things all the time to make what I call Ojibwe art. More so, I'm also or my father and his ancestors were from the Dakota Lake. And I won't really be talking about that because I don't really have any culture or information from those Dakota Lake. When that hanging happened, all of those people were like throwing leaves and wind. All that culture, the recognition of the people, the ancestry that we might receive from those people was privileged. My father was obviously a descendant of that. He had no culture, no recognition from his people. He collected coins. He was as white Caucasian as anybody. I don't really tell people that I'm from the Dakota side of the Ojibwe. That would be really a reference to that. You know, when we talk about history of the Americas, you always hear the story of his ancestor, that ancestor came along, and fortunately they got onto the boat when they made it here, somehow they found their first dollar or something, or in. Through the luck of the draw, they managed to land somewhere. And that's the story of America, that people from all over the world landed here, and through the luck of the draw, they landed at some particular place in the U.S. And their ancestor founded such and such a town. And it's a very common story. It's like you took a handful of cards and threw them in the air, and people landed where they may, and that's the history here. That's not the history of Ojibwe. We come from the east coast of this country, and we've worked our way east. And it was a planning. We weren't just randomly like, we'll see what's over there, and a few of us stayed, and then a few more moved on. We followed what we call a prophecy. Our planning committee, so to speak, in that we had a vision of where we wanted to go. We didn't particularly know exactly where that was, but we had a plan. And the plan was, we're seeking the place where food grows from the water. And that was what we were looking for. And that's where we are now, in this county, in Minnesota. We're in a place where food grows on the water. And the food itself is monomic or wild rice, as we like to call it. And so that's what we were looking for as we moved from east to west. And each time we would come to some new place and we would find some food that grew on the water, but we were looking for more signs than that. We were looking for a specific place where the food grew on the water. And so, as our gradual migration moved from east to west across the Great Lakes, and we're predominantly meat and vegetable consumers, so we always needed that big hunting ground, so to speak. And we fought on those feathers. We're always a very aggressive people. It's significant. In the names of some of the people and tribes among the But as we moved from east to west, and we found that the major stopping places along the way, and this is all taken directly from a historical website, from a White Invasion website, so if you can see any of this there. And so, in the end, we continued along until we came to basically the Great Lakes and then Minnesota. We are in Minnesota, and the shape of the state is very specifically decided by wild rice, by birch bark, by the needs of the Ojibwe. We claim these resources as things that we require, and that's kind of why we're here, and why the shape of the state is what it is. So if you look at Minnesota, which we could look at Minnesota, you'd notice there's a big square spot at the top of Minnesota. That's very specifically there because we needed birch bark for canoes to harvest wild rice. And so in the negotiations, when we decided the border between Minnesota and Canada, we very specifically required that section because it's notable birch bark, which we needed to make canoes, which the Europeans purchased from the Native Americans. And so that was kind of the reason for that particular section of Minnesota. That doesn't show it there. And also, we have 110 species of wild rice in Minnesota. And so that's to say that, most people think that we just have wild rice, and that's a common misnomer, because the 110 species of wild rice that Minnesota contains are a wide range of wild rice. We have different types of wild rice that we harvest and process in different ways. There we go. And so here we have a map of Whitewood itself, and that's where I'm from. And if you look at it, then you'll see that there's shaded sections and there's non-shaded sections. The shaded sections are the sections still retained by land. Whereas when you're in the square, you are on the wider reservation. The actual property owned by the reservation is very small. I guess I'm not as familiar with that because of that. And so, when we look at some of the history previous that formed this whole region, you see that here we have some advertisements that I took from the book called The Constable Inn. And these advertisements are from the Ponsford town itself. And here we have Ron T's Cash Store, or Tessin Store, for the Ponsford Garage, the Ponsford Hotel, Nun's Cash Grocery, Ponsford Ponsford All Indian Baseball Team, tackles all teams, seldom loses the lineup. And so, basically, none of these businesses exist now. This was a false economy, kind of perpetuated in the sale of wagons over time, and that these businesses were supported over the gradual consuming the resources of what had been saved on its land. It supported these businesses and maintained them up until the point when those resources were gone, and then that was the end of all these businesses. None of these businesses exist in modern times. And so here we have Lower Rice Lake. This is one of our premier rice lakes. We pass a lot of rice up to come to this particular lake, and the rules on the reservation are dodge and dust. So I'm always very careful to keep it right at dawn, and I work till dusk. Traditionally, people will harvest two people to a canoe. I don't always have the ability to go and find a partner, and so I had to teach myself how to harvest by myself. And this is kind of a unique technique in that most people harvest in a team with two people in the canoe, one pulling and the other with two flails, harvesting the wild rice. Basically, you just go along and the grain grows on the stalks, and when it's ripe, we go up and we harvest it. And so, as I was saying, wild rice has generated the shape of Minnesota in that we required certain wild rice, and every treaty that we made was to retain access to those specific breeds and types of wild rice and pretty vast beds of wild rice. This is actually the Lower Rice Lake. It's on the White Indian Reservation, and it's one of our premier ricing places. I try to go here every year, and I get the majority of my food from there. And actually, I'll be offering some wild rice from Lower Rice Lake here after we're done with the presentation. The technique here of just pulling the rice over the boat and only taking the right grains of rice so that you don't get a mixture of ripe and unripe grains, and so that the process is easier, and you get a symmetry in the grain, and that you're only taking the right grains and not the unripe grains. So that after we're done harvesting, the next stage of parching the wild rice over a fire, and then threshing the hull from the wild rice, and then ending up with that final product is made way easier by only harvesting the ripe wild rice. I've been doing this all of my life since I was a pretty young kid. My grandfather taught me how to harvest wild rice. The first time I harvested wild rice, he took me out on the river, we got into the boat, and I did the pole. I pushed with the pole, and he had the two flails, and I worked, pushing him along in the boat, and it seemed like, we worked really hard, after I, pushed him along the boat as far as I could, and thought, we're really making good progress. We've got a long ways up into the river, and I was just about as tired as I could be. I looked at him, to see if he was pleased, and he looked at me, and he gave me a really funny look, and he said, "Please get me into the rice." So I guess I wasn't as working quite as good as I thought. But since then, the technique has improved. And when I do the thing with the stick, like a baton, it's more of a nervous gesture just because I've used a flail all my life. And unfortunately, the reason I'm kind of spinning the flail is because I've realized that I got on the Lower Rice Lake and I started in a particular direction. And I was going wrong. All the good guys were in the other direction, and so unfortunately, I think I only got maybe a couple hundred pounds that day, and I really had to work for it. Lower Rice Lake is about 3.5 miles long and a little over maybe not quite a mile wide. It's a huge kind of a worm-shaped lake, and lots of people get lost out there. If you grew up on it, you kind of generally know where you're at, and so I've never felt much concern just because of, like, you know, it's a really big lake, but wherever you are, you're still kind of home. It's hard to get lost in your own yard, so to speak. You know? And so, let's see if we can get out of here, because that's kind of the point where I realize I've really gone the wrong way. And so, I'm not sure if we're going to go to see if this one will work. No? No, that's not going to work. Okay, now that our video is going to go over to Linux and a MacBook. Okay, here we have some of the equipment that we use for processing wild rice. This is a fan email. There's a pressure. This is all very old equipment. A lot of the equipment we use is antiquated in most people's view of ag equipment, as, and so is most of mine, is antiques, I guess you would refer to them now. But they work for me. The thing with harvesting wild rice is keeping it clean. You know, it's been lost over time that the wild rice, as you harvest it, you pick any stick or any particular thing out of it, and the processing of the wild rice goes way quicker. And you don't have, you don't want sand in your bowl, because basically that's your soup bowl. Everything that you end up in the canoe, you want to be able to consume at one point. So keeping a clean canoe and you know, a clean wild rice is very important. That's kind of gotten lost in a lot of people view, and that they think just eat it all into the bowl.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I'm just really curious about, you were talking about different varieties of rice, and that, you know,
basically, I'm from Whiter, so what we call the best of the best is Lower Rice Lake rice. And that being said, the reason why is my family's always harvested wild rice. I got it from my parents and my grandparents and so on. And so our standard for wild rice is a little higher than a lot of people's. We like a medium grain wild rice, and so it finishes easier, it processes easier, whereas when you get a larger grain wild rice, it tends to break up. A larger grain wild rice is harder to process, whereas a shorter grain wild rice, it used to be like fat in the middle, and that also is hard to process, and the hull tends to be harder to come off. The thing with high quality wild rice is each reservation has their own idea of what is a high quality wild rice, and that lake will tell you that they have the best rice. You know, they're kind of confused. we have it at Whiter, and it's a lower rice lake. And so, as I was saying, each reservation tends to have their own idea of what really good wild rice is. And so, that being said, they also have their idea of the recipe for processing really good about rice. And then it varies. In that lake, they like to hand parch their wild rice. And they have that really big, long grain round rice. And so they're almost stuck with that hand parching technique. They use a dry seasoned birch wood to parch it. And they use long paddles and they turn it by hand. And it's hand parched. And from there, they're able to use equipment to process it. But the parching test tends to be by hand because of the really large grain, and, which is, for us a little more difficult with our automatic parchers. We still use wood, but we use mowers to drive big parchers, which I don't have any pictures of today. But wild rice, 110 species from Minnesota. That being said, the processing technique for each of those species can be a little bit different. So if I take one grain from one lake, I can affect the color and flavor of that particular grain up to four or five different ways. So that from that one day, I can have up to five different colors of wild rice, starting with a really light green and going to a dark black and to the reds and the grays. The recipe for processing wild rice is kind of like, how long do you wait after you harvest it? Are you going to let it sit in the sun and cure itself into a darker grain? Or are you going to process it immediately and get it with a green colored grain? What type of wood do you use in the smoking of the wild rice? I like a standard popple or birch or sometimes a red oak, but that tends to get a little hot and you tend to pop a little bit of wild rice. And so the flavor of wild rice is also affected by the type of wood that you use in parching. And so that's kind of the different stages of the recipe. Before you ever get the rice in the kitchen, it's gone through some type of recipe, and each reservation is almost adamant that their particular processing technique is the way to process wild rice. So we're kind of divided in that. Besides wild rice, we do maple syrup, based black ash, a little bit of birch bark, and a lot of different types of bark. This is Minnesota granite. Most statuary you'll see that's made out of stone is actually a soapstone. Minnesota, we don't have a lot of soapstone, so I use granite in fabrication. I'm going to show you more. Minnesota, being a moraine, so to speak, in big regions of Minnesota, the moraine, when the glacier melted, basically it deposited stone here from up to 500 miles in any particular direction. And those stones have sat over time. Just a page earlier. There you go. So when it deposited those, the peak of that sort of moraine is called the height of the land, which is a little bit north up here and to the west. And the height of the land is where I live. And that's kind of where I get my stone. Basically, I look for stones that already look like something, and I just try to finish that look. This is a granite and quartz mix. I always look for a Native American paint. We've got unique stone from this entire region that was deposited basically right there on the moraine. There's a little bit of sandstone, and not a lot of things beside granite survived that whole ice age process, and so mostly all we have is granite. And so that's basically what I use. I use diamond blades that when I started, the first diamond blade I got was about $90. Since then, industrial diamond blades have gotten much cheaper. I can get the same blade now for about $15 to $20. And I just mount it on an angle grinder and look for a promiscuous stone that is inspired something, to carve. And I do a little bit of wood for birch bark. This is a mask I did. Here's some more stones. This is a tournament of 13 moons. This would be what you would call our calendar, basically, in that we have a 12-month calendar, which all of you follow. But then also there's a lunar calendar, which is less than all, and it goes by the lunar months of the year. And each year goes through 13 lunar months, and that's represented by the divisions on the turtleback. And then the full calendar would be, in this picture here, we have the turtle and the 13 moons, and then the edge is divided up into 28 days. And that would be the full calendar of the year. And each of these little divisions would be represented by a pictograph design that basically denotes what you would be doing at that stage of the year. So like in the middle of the year, you would have the sort of storytelling moon, and the spring you have the sugar bush moon, which is a little design that basically denotes that you'd be doing maple sugar at a certain time. And this calendar could work anywhere around the world, except for the fact that the designs would be slightly different wherever you are to represent whatever natural phenomenon is occurring in that region of the world. So, sugar bush here, where we make maple syrup, would be slightly different, maybe way to the east or way to the west. But at some point, you would, be doing some sort of agricultural type of activity. And that's what's denoted on this calendar. Every lunar month is represented by some sort of activity, and that was our pictograph of calendar. Like in the fall, you have the harvest moon, which, say in the southern hemisphere, you have a completely different set of pictographs, but you could still follow this same 13 lunar months. This calendar works all over the world, but the specific pictograph design would only work for a small region, by your latitude and longitude, basically. And so that's just one of my sculptures there. But basically, here's a quartz one I did for my brother, and it was just a piece of quartz that he found somewhere, and he asked me to carve it into something, and so that's what I did. And it's a 4.5-inch blade, so the graphics, it takes a pretty fine hand to be able to design a three-dimensional sculpture with a 4.5-inch blade. These are some teepees and different things that I make just to kind of keep expanding my repertoire. This is black ash basketry. This was real common to the Ojibwe. Basically, it's a black ash log that we take and pound on it to separate the sticks and produce those strips to weave into baskets, and then you split the strips, to make a shiny surface and a coarse surface. a lot of people use dye to dye different colors so that you can make you know, the contrast, you know. And so it's a very common thing, except for that my niece and nephew, they're pounding a lot to actually produce strips. Oops, something else. But black ash basketry used to be super common, and then a good way to carve black ash baskets, like they're filled with water, and that was some very fine weaving. This is just a piece of pine that I carved. Maybe have more than that. And most of what I carved is either quartz or granite, because that's what's basically available to me. Here we have the Trail of the Eternal 13 Moons, which was compliments of the wet tile saw I got from Region 2 Arts Grant. Here we go, there's the Eternal 13 Moons. This is a big one I did, that's down in the Minneapolis Indian Center, and basically I donated it there just because we were not represented, and I didn't see representation anywhere. And so basically an entryway to their now defunct gallery, there's a glass case, and inside there is the Eternal 13 Moons with the 28-day edge. But it's lacking any of the symbols that Kurt was working on for the calendar of the year. Just more stone. Here is what a friend of mine did for me. It's basically wood burning on a guitar with some Ojibwe. Currently, there's kind of some dispute as to our rights to certain areas of harvest, and basically in our treaties, we've always retained the right to harvest wild rice and specifically fish and lots of things, and so currently we're not purchasing harvest permits from the DNR, and we've always retained the right to harvest those things. And so that's kind of where things stand at the moment, in that we need wild rice, and that's basically what we live on, you know. It's our life, you know. And so I guess I couldn't go into the details of the negotiations as they stand right now, but I'm hoping things kind of remain the same, and that I need wild rice. I'm hoping that my children will be able to have wild rice. It's why they're here. You know, we started on the East Coast, and we ended up in this country because of wild rice. You know, we're pilgrims just like you people, you know. We fought to be here. We fought a lot of people in order to plan this area. And that's why our Ojibwe are here now, because we came here to seek this land of our prophecy.
Should we open up the discussion? Does anyone else have some questions for us now? Touch on the history of White Earth, how it was settled, and how beginning to now, you know, what's going on with trying to
figure everything. Well, I kind of just skipped over that part of the PowerPoint, I guess. Maybe we can find it. There we go. So basically, White Earth was founded as one of the last great new deal, basically. And after the founding, it wasn't as popular as people thought. It wasn't a great new deal. And so in order to populate it, I guess Ojibwe from all different tribes and nations kind of rounded up and brought here. And so White Earth is a conglomeration of a lot of different Ojibwe from a lot of different tribes. And we kind of settled in different parts of White Earth. And so White Earth is actually a mix of most Ojibwe tribes kind of put together.